Canto 3 of The Journey of Dr. Syntax in Search of the Picturesque by William Coombe. Canto 3. By the roadside, within the wood, in this sad state poor Syntax stood. His bosom heaved with many a sigh, and the tears stood out in either eye. What could he do? He durst not bawl. His noise the robbers might recall. The villains might again surround him, and hang him up where they had bound him. Sure never was a hapless wight in more uncomfortable plight. Nor was this all. His pate was bare, unsheltered by one lock of hair, for when the sturdy robbers took him, his hat and peruke both forsook him. The insect world were on the wing, whose talent is to buzz and sting, and soon his bare-worn head they sought, by instinct led, by nature taught, and dug their little forks within the tender texture of his skin. He raged and roared, but all in vain. No means he found to ease his pain. The cords which to the tree had tied him, all help from either hand denied him. He shook his head, he writhed his face, with painful look, with sad grimace, and thus he spoke his hapless case. "Ah, miserable man," he cried, "what perils do my course betide? In this sad melancholy state must I, alas, impatient wait, till some kind soul shall haply find me, and with his friendly hands unbind me. Nay, I throughout the night must stay, 'tis such an unfrequented way, though what with hunger, thirst, and fright, I ne'er shall last throughout the night. And could I e'en these ills survive, the flies will eat me up alive. What mad ambition made me roam? Ah, wherefore did I quit my home? For there I lived remote from harm. My meals were good, my house was warm. And though I was not free from strife with other ills that trouble life, yet I had learned full well to bear the nightly scold, the daily care. And after many a season past, I should have found repose at last. Fate would have signed my long release, and Syntax would have died in peace, nor thus been robbed and tied and beaten, and all alive by insect eaten. And while he thus at fate was railing, and fortune's angry frown bewailing, a dog's approaching bark he hears. 'Twas sweet as music to his ears, and soon a sure relief appears. For though it bears that general form which oft at home foretold a storm, it now appeared an angel's shape that promised him a quick escape. Nor did La Mancha's valorous knight feel greater pleasure at the sight, when, overwhelmed with love and awe, his Dulcinea first he saw. For on two trotting palfreys came, and each one bore a comely dame. They started at his form to view, the horses also started too. The dog with insult seemed to treat him, and looked as if he longed to eat him. In piteous tones he humbly prayed they'd turn aside and give him aid, when each leapt quickly from her steed to join in charitable deed. They drew their knives to cut the noose, and let the mournful prisoner loose. With kindest words his fate bewail, while grateful Syntax tells his tale. The rustic matrons soothe his grief, nor offer but afford relief, and turning from the beaten road, their well-lined panniers they unload, when soon upon the bank appeared a sight his fainting spirits cheered. They spread the fare with cheerful grace, and gave a banquet to the place. Most haply, too, as they untied him, he saw his hat, and wig beside him. So thus bewigg'd and thus behatted, down on the grass the doctor squatted. When he uplifted either eye, with grateful accents to the sky, 'tis thus, he humbly said, we read in sacred books of heavenly deed. And thus I find, in my distress, the manner of the wilderness. 'Tis hermit's fare, but thanks to heaven, and those kind souls by whom 'tis given, 'tis true that bread and curds and fruit do with the pious hermit's suit. But Syntax surely was mistaken to think their meals partake of bacon, or that those reverend men regale, as our good doctors do, with ale. And those kind dames, in nothing loath, took care that he partook of both. At length 'twas time to bid adieu, and each their different way pursue. A kind farewell, a kiss as kind, he gave them both with heart and mind. Then off he trudged, and as he walked, thus to himself the parson talked. 'Tis well, I think, it is no worse, for I have only lost my purse. With all their cruelty and pains, those rogues have got but trifling gains. Poor 4 and 4 pence is the measure of all their mighty pilfered treasure. For haply there was no divining, I'd a snug pocket in my lining. And, thanks to Spousy, every note was well sewed up within my coat. But where is Grizzle? Never mind her. I'll have her cried, and soon she'll find her.' Thus he pursued the winding way, big with the evils of the day, though the good doctor kept in view the favour of his blessings too. Nor had he paced it half an hour before he saw a parish tower, and soon, with sore fatigue oppressed, an inn received him as its guest. But still his mind, with anxious care, pondered upon his wandering mare. He therefore sent the bellman round to see if Grizzle might be found. Grizzle, ungrateful to her master and careless of his foul disaster, left him tied up and took her way in hopes to meet with corn or hay. But as that did not come to pass, she sought a meadow full of grass. The farmer on the meadow found her and ordered John his man to pound her. Now John was one of those droll folk who oft take mischief for a joke, and thought 'twould make the master stare when he again beheld his mare. Perhaps the gemman might be shocked to find her ready cropped and docked. At all event, he played his fun. No sooner was it said than done. But Grizzle was a patient beast, and minded naught if she could feast, like many another prone to think the best of life was meat and drink, who feel today nor care nor sorrow if they are sure to feast to-morrow. Thus Grizzle, as she paced around the purlieu of the barren pound, in hungry mood might seem to neigh, 'If I had water, corn, and hay, I should not thus my fate bewail, nor mourn the loss of ears or tail.' In the meantime, securely housed, the doctor boozed it and caroused. The hostess spread her fairest cheer, her best beefsteak, her strongest beer, and soothed him with her winning chat of, 'Pray this, and now take that, your reverence, after all your fright, wants meat and drink to set you right.' His reference praised the golden rule, nor did he let his victuals cool, and having drunk his liquor out, he took a turn to look about. When to the folks about the door he told the dismal story o'er, the country people on him gazed, and heard his perils all amazed. How the thieves twined the cords around him, how to a tree the villains bound him, what angels came to his release, to loose his bonds and soothe his grief. His loss of cash, and what was worse, his saddle, saddle-bags, and horse. Thus, as their rude attention hung upon the wonders of his tongue, lo! Grizzle's altered form appears, with half its tail and half its ears. "Is there no law?" the doctor cries. "Plenty," a lawyer straight replies. "Employ me, and the thieves shall swing on gallows tree in hempen string. And for the rogue, the law shall flea him who maimed your horse, as now you see him." "No," quoth the Don, "your pardon, pray. I've had enough of thieves today. I've lost 4 shillings and a groat, but you would strip me of my coat. And ears and tail won't fatten you. You'll want the head and carcass too." He chuckled as he made the stroke, and all around enjoyed the joke. But still it was a sorry sight to see the beast in such a plight. Yet what could angry Syntax do? 'Twas all in vain to fret and stew. His well-stuffed bags, with all their hoard of sketching tools, were safe restored. The saddle, too, which he had sought for small reward, was quickly brought. He therefore thought it far more sage to stop his threats and check his rage. So to the ostler's faithful care he gave his mutilated mare, and while poor Grizzle, free from danger, cropped the full rack and cleaned the manger, Syntax, to ease his aching head, smoked out his pipe and went to bed. End of Canto 3.